I'm glad to be in California. Don, native Californian, I'm almost a native. In Texas, if you weren't born in Texas, you can claim to be a Texan if you have a child born in the state or if you get baptized in the Brazos River. And I didn't get baptized in California, but I did have a son that was born here in Santa Monica, California when I was at USC. And I hope my Stanford colleagues and UCLA and Berkeley don't hold that against me, but I had a good time being a Trojan. I still get things from the Alumni Association. Maybe I ought to give them some money. Then I had a granddaughter in California and still lives down in Laguna Beach with my daughter. And so I've been coming to California for many, many years. Always enjoy being here and look forward to coming back in more than I have in the past. Well, John, thanks for that introduction. In talking to him a little bit before we got started, he recognized my accent and I recognized his. He's from Louisiana, Baton Rouge, as we say. Not too far from Houston. Good folks over there in Baton Rouge. Well, I always like to start my talks with something funny. And I heard this joke told by Dr. Red Duke. How many of you have ever heard of Dr. Red Duke? Anybody? Well, hey, one hand. All right. You want to stand up and tell us how you know Dr. Red Duke? There you go. All right. Well, Dr. Duke is a trauma surgeon. He was one of the two at Parkland Hospital when JFK was brought in, God bless him. Came to Houston and started the Life Flight program. It's been very successful in running helicopters to pick people up and bring them to Herman Hospital, which is associated with the University of Texas. And so Dr. Duke is a real character. He used to have a TV program in which he would sign off and say, I'm Dr. Red Duke, University of Texas Health Science Center in Houston. Everybody tuned in to hear him to say pretty much that. He's a funny guy. But he told this story about a young doctor. Next appointment up was this fellow coming in for his 65-year-old Medicare checkup. And the doctor gave him a checkup and came back with the results and said, you know, you're in pretty good shape. And the guy said, well, Doc said, what are the odds of me making it to 85? And nobody ever asked the doctor that question before. So he had to really think fast on his feet. And he remembered this lecture from Dr. Red Duke at University of Texas Medical School about lifestyle. So he said, well, I'll ask you a few questions here. He said, do you smoke? And, oh, no, my primary care doctor told me never to do that. And, well, that's good. Well, when you go outside, do you wear a lot of sunscreen if you go sailing or golfing or things like that, play tennis? Oh, no, I hardly ever go outside. My primary care doctor told me sun was really bad for you, so I just pretty much stay inside. He said, well, what about your diet? Do you eat a lot of red meat? Oh, no, nothing but chicken and fish. And Doc said, you know, you don't ever want to have a good greasy hamburger? Oh, no. He said, well, what about risky behaviors? Do you go ziplining and hang gliding and stuff like, oh no. So he went through three or four things like that. Young doctor taking notes, he added it all up. He said, why in the world would you want to make it to 85? Well, that's the humor part. What we're here to talk about today is if you make it to 85, some things happen. And one of them is dementia, sadly. And some of the things that happened to folks with that. Well, I'm delighted to be here. Alana Golden, who is our colleague from the California Department of Business Oversight, gave a great talk last year at Stanford. Is Dr. Dolores Gallagher-Thompson and her colleagues from Stanford here? They were here earlier. My colleagues put on a great program. Well, I see them back over there. Last year, and Alana came. She was to have been here this morning. And at 11 o'clock last night, when I was arriving at the San Francisco airport and communicating back and forth to Don, she said she was just too ill to make it, God bless her. So she's at a doctor's office this morning. So Don's going to cover her talk, and so I'm going to go first, then Don, and then he'll do Alana's talk. And we'll try to stretch this a little bit. I'm going to show you a video in a minute. Be thinking about your experiences with elders, and in particular, any that you might have observed having problems with activities of daily living, mainly instrumental activities of daily living, that might put them at peril of being financially exploited. So if you have an experience like that, have a story to tell, we have microphones. And so we're going to ask you to stand and tell us your stories in the last 30 minutes of our talk. So without further ado, let me just thank everybody who's on the program here today and all of the sponsors. Look at this slide. It almost looks like Phil Mickelson at the Masters, you know, with all that stuff on his golf shirt and all the advertisers, but we got to do that. So thanks to Don Blandon from the Investor Protection Trust in Atlanta who couldn't be with us, and thanks to the Alzheimer's Association and all you folks that have invited us to come here. I'm associated with the Southeast Texas and Houston Alzheimer's Association. We do a great job down there, and I know y'all do here, too. So important. Well, let's go see if this is going to work. And it didn't. I was given this remote and said, mash the button on the right. Let's see if that works. Yeah. Clicker's not working. This gentleman, what would we do without high-tech guys? My geek index is about a 3. Nah, not that high. On a 10, I wish it were. I'd be working up the road here somewhere, Silicon Valley, making some money, playing golf at Pebble Beach. Well, I've got another joke to tell, but... I might as well tell it while he's fixing it up. Madge and her girlfriends playing bridge, been playing bridge for 40 years. And you can imagine at the 40-year mark, things happen, and they rotate to each other's houses for, you know, once a week for a month to play bridge. And it's Madge's turn to have the girls at her house. And so they all get there, and before they get started, they get talking about life. And one of them said, my arthritis is so bad I can hardly shuffle the cards anymore. And boy, that opened the door. Next one said, my eyesight's so bad, I can hardly see the cards anymore. Third one said, since Bob died last year, I've been kind of depressed and don't really enjoy these as much as I used to. Mad said, girls, I'm so sorry y'all are having problems. I don't have any, knock on wood. Come in. I'll get me an agent and get on the Letterman show except it's over. All right. Well, that's this slide. And oh, darn. Here we go. It's a collaboration between all these people. We started in 2009. And let me just tell you why we started. It has a California connection. Christopher Cox was then a member of Congress from Newport Beach, California. And he also is a USC grad and a member of my college fraternity. And I'd met him at an alumni event at the Big Canyon Country Club in Newport Beach. Any of y'all ever been there? You're in tall cotton when you're at the Big Canyon Country Club. And so I had met him once or twice. And then he became chairman of the House Committee on National Homeland Security. And I was working in an area that time. And so I called on him as a member of Congress. Then he became commissioner of the Securities and Exchange Commission, United States of America. And he wrote a piece in the AARP Bulletin, I think it was around 2007, Don, decrying the fact that his elderly parents in Newport Beach, in their 90s, early 90s, one with both frail, one with dementia, had been gypped out of all their money by an unscrupulous financial advisor. And they were dead broke. And they spiraled down very quickly and both died shortly afterwards. And this was after the sitting commissioner of the Securities and Exchange Commission had sent cease and desist letters. And by the way, Chris was a Harvard-trained lawyer, had worked in the Reagan White House, been a member of Congress. I mean, the guy's got clout. And this financial advisor never responded to these cease and desist letters. So the thought went through my mind. If this could happen to the parents of this commissioner of the Securities and Exchange Commission, it can happen to anybody. I'd known about elder abuse, but I never thought about it in the context of financial exploitation. and the consequences of that. And so I called his office and asked, could I come see him? I'd met him before. And he was up on the hill testifying, and his appointment secretary told me, said, you don't really need to see the commissioner, although I'm sure he'd be glad to see you. You need to go to Austin, Texas, and meet with Denny Crawford at the TSSB. I'd never heard of the TSSB. I'm a native Texan. You're going to hear some things today about maybe an agency that you've never heard of before. It's very instrumental in helping you not be defrauded yourself or your patients or your clients. So it stands for the Texas State Securities Board, Don. And it's every state has the counterpart to the SEC. So I'm in Austin, Texas the next week talking to Denny about this idea of maybe training doctors to be a little more aware of financial fraud as part of their screen for older people when they see them. And she said, well, you don't need to talk to me, you need to talk to Don Blandon at the IPT. I'd never heard of the IPT before. And so make a long story short, I'm here with Don, who's president and CEO of the IPT, who funded this pilot project in Texas in 2009. Very successful, we think, at least in having clinicians say, yes, I now recognize this. I hadn't thought about this. It never dawned on me to start asking a few questions like, who's managing your money? Have you changed your will? Has anybody asked you to, you know, have a power of attorney? Things like that. So Don thought that there was enough success in Texas to make this national, so he put the program together. And this is, I think, our 80th presentation, Don, around the country. We just had one in Dublin, Ireland, 2 weeks ago. And with this attendance, we just went over the 8,000 mark. So give everybody applause. Thank you for coming. So we've been doing this all over the country, as I said, and it's been very rewarding. And it would not have been possible without the association with all of these organizations. So now let's see if this keeps on working. All right, this is going to be a video clip entitled that you won't forget. And you'll see why in just a minute, and how do I get it to come on. He's going to do it. I'm going to sit down. It lasts 8 minutes, but Violet was a person you'll never forget.
He made you feel like he was a good old boy, and you were his best friend.
Hello. Hello, come in.
All you need to do is bring money, and that was the big sell.
How much money do you want this time?
7,000 should take care of us for now. Be very happy with this.
I'm sure I will, with you handling it.
He looked like a nice young man. You know, go to church every Sunday and all that.
Elder financial abuse is a national epidemic, especially when it comes to seniors with some form of cognitive impairment, such as dementia or early Alzheimer's. Every fifth American now over the age of 65, that's almost 7.5 million people, have already been victimized by financial fraud, making these seniors our nation's most exploited citizens.
1 in 5 of everybody you see on these sidewalks in about 20 years will be age 65 or older. And 20 years after that, 50% of them are going to have some cognitive impairment, dementia, that will make them extremely vulnerable to being defrauded of their money.
Each year, con artists swindle elders out of more than $2.5 billion. Being a victim of fraud can make you dead broke. Older people just don't have time to make up for the losses.
Older people control 70% of the wealth in this country. So the money is there, and you have professional scam artists who know where the money is, and they've developed a great set of tools to go get it.
Most licensed broker-dealers and investment advisors are legitimate, but there are a few bad apples, like there is in everything else in life. And they can really come forth with a product that sounds too good to be true, and it probably is, and they use it like you would an instrument of mass destruction. It's a very dangerous situation today, and it's getting more dangerous.
People look at me and figure, number one, she's old. Number two, she's a woman. Number three, she won't be able to do anything about it anyway.
So why do we become more vulnerable to financial fraud as we age? What actually happens to our brains?
The older brain shrinks in size. There's less fluid in it. It's not as big as it used to be. The neurons, electrical signals, the pathways for cognitive function are all impaired. Then when you overlay cognitive impairment on this normal age-related change, then you have an individual who is not fully capable of making sound financial decisions.
Karen Wilson understands that all too well.
She was incapacitated. She was in a situation where she was completely broke. She had no money left.
Helplessly, she watched as her mother's cognitive capacity started to decline.
She was really a wonderful mother, really sweet and calm and caring. I'd taken her shopping and we went into a jewelry store, and just for fun, like a breakfast at Tiffany's moment, I looked at a ring and I said, "I love this, do you?" And she said, "Yeah." She said, "I'll buy it for you." And I said, "Mother, it's like $60,000. And she goes, "That's okay, I have my checkbook." And I knew she was being serious, and I knew that she was not okay mentally.
People with early onset dementia are more willing to gamble literally with their money. And of course, some dishonest quote-unquote money managers take advantage. And the result? Countless horror stories.
I have an aunt who lives in the Midwest. One afternoon she got a phone call, and during this phone call she was convinced to send $5,000 Western Union, which she did. So she called the police and they tried to trace it, and of course by that time the money was gone.
A gentleman in Houston was treated for having fallen to the Nigerian email scam. He had about $750,000 and he lost all but $35,000. And he felt like if he gave that last $35,000, he'd got all his money back.
Even legitimate everyday investing opportunities can become a nightmare.
We had one example where a 90-year-old woman was advised to go into a 15-year or 12-year CD, which was totally inappropriate. She made the investment. The person that sold it to her was legitimate, but used very bad judgment, and it really wasn't suitable for her.
Yes, it's very frustrating. They look at you and think, "Oh, if she doesn't have anything left up there, we can rip her off and it'll be okay." And it's not okay.
Hand in hand with financial abuse is the shame of having been taken. It's embarrassing to fall for a high-pressure sale or a friendly voice on the phone promising fantastic returns.
We decided to take her checking account out of her hands because, you know, there were checks being written that we couldn't document. I mean, we should have started preparing 15 or 20 years earlier.
When a loved one is in cognitive decline, family members can be in massive denial, unable to reverse the roles of who was caring for whom.
She died in a deficit situation, somebody who'd worked that hard her whole life. I'm guilty. I wasn't there. I didn't do the right things.
So what can we do to stem the rising tide of financial abuse? Do medical professionals have a responsibility to protect our vulnerable elders?
Any healthcare provider knows that they have an ethical and legal responsibility to report elder abuse. Financial fraud is elder abuse, pure and simple.
Talking together about financial fraud, the same way you would discuss high blood pressure or diabetes, is a good prescription for prevention. So, becoming educated is key.
On our intake form in our office, we do have a question: are you having financial difficulties or stress? And if appropriate, we can help refer people to community resources.
Even people with mild cognitive impairment lose the ability to make good financial decisions.
People with mild cognitive impairment can go to the opera, play golf, go out to dinner with friends, have fun, almost be like their old selves, with the exception of managing their money. They make financial errors four times that of persons who don't have mild cognitive impairment.
There are signs that can help healthcare providers and family members identify a potential problem. Has a patient or relative become socially isolated? Have they made questionable financial decisions or been asked to change their will? Have you noticed deterioration in their ability to make daily decisions?
The worst thing you can do is be disconnected and isolated.
your parents need for you to take control. They need to have one of their children manage their health care and manage their investments at the same time.
State securities regulators and medical professionals, in partnership with Adult Protective Services, have recognized this perfect storm and are tackling it head-on, knowing full well that the tsunami of aging baby boomers will double the number of older Americans, which could double the risk of exploited seniors over the next 20 years.
Thanks a lot.
Everybody needs to stop and think of themselves as someday being a frail older person and asking him or herself, what type of systems do I want to have in place when it's my turn?
We know that it's difficult to get involved in somebody else's business. It's not fun, it takes time, there's certain liability involved, and we recognize that. And we at the state level are going to try to ease that so that it's minimal.
That's our goal, is to help everybody have as good an old age as they can.
I have complete faith in people. I keep thinking that maybe they just have had a bad day or a bad situation. You kind of hate to give up on people. So you just keep hoping that things get better.
I forgot to tell you to pull out your Kleenex before you watch this. Violet is the patient of Dr. Rebecca Elon, the geriatrician that was shown here in the video, who was our first geriatrics fellow at Baylor College of Medicine. And the producers of this show were the Pennsylvania Securities Commission, Don helped arrange. Bob Lamb, who was shown in there, was the chairman. I think, Bob, is he retired now, Don, living down in Florida? How old is Bob? He's late 80s, I think.
84,
all right, mid-80s. Did a great job, and we've shown this across the country. It has an impact. And the story about the other lady in the on the program, too, these are just two stories of probably hundreds of thousands across the country who you don't know about, we don't hear about. Occasionally, you'll read about it in the newspaper where there's been a conviction of a scam. But it's pretty bad. And the point that was made in this, and we'll get on to the slides next, is that these are our learning objectives. Let me just state them real quickly. You can read them. Attendees should be able to list key factors that increase an older person's vulnerability to financial fraud, describe common financial exploitation schemes and practices, and describe when and where to refer patients deemed at high risk. Almost, if I had been a lawyer, I could have rested my case, if you will, after showing that video. But let's go through some of these slides, and maybe there's a point or two in here that will be new information to you. For example, 35% of everybody in this country, 71 years of age or older, that includes me, already has MCI or some form of dementia. That's kind of a scary prospect. Of course, 65% don't, and that's good news, but over a third. As the video talked about, Dan Marson is the guru at University of Alabama at Birmingham, and his research shows that people with MCI make four times the financial errors than those without the condition. Elders losing significant amounts of money. I just don't have the time to make them up. I have a 45-year-old son in Austin, Texas. He's doing very well financially, thank goodness. That means he won't be coming back to our house. and he picks up bills now. That's really great when your son picks up the dinner bill. But if he and I both lost the same amount of money, he's got time to make it up. And I just flat out don't. And that's the big difference in aging in that regard. If losses are significant, and a young doctor here in California, Eric Wadira, right up the road here at the University of California at San Francisco, wrote a paper in the Journal of the American Medical Association, I think in 2011, about his cases that he had seen there and made the point that it becomes a clinical situation when your patient comes to you and they've lost enough money where they have to choose between paying for their rent and their food and their transportation and utilities versus the out-of-pocket cost for health care that they then forego. Then they start spiraling down and it becomes a health-related issue. So that's the whole point, really, of why we do this thing. Well, the recent Institute of Medicine report showed that in addition to the 35% of the people who have MCI, we've got all these folks, another 14 to 20% that have one or more mental health problems. They too are more vulnerable to being financially defrauded, and depressive disorders and dementia-related problems are most prevalent. Of all elder abuses cases reported, 30% were financial exploitation. That's an old study, probably need to get that updated. I suspect I've heard range up to 50%, 40 to 50% at least. Two nationally representative studies found that 4% of all older adults in the U.S. Have been victims of financial abuse. Don's survey was later than that. He's showing up to 20% of everybody in this country has at least been, there's been an attempt made to defraud them. And then to put this in the context of why this is important to clinicians, if Dr. Longo were still here, I think he would agree with us. And are there other clinicians in here who have private practices, who see older patients in their practices? If you are, you would agree, too, and all of you would, I think, that if you have a prevalence of a major medical issue that's high enough to warrant being treated, you treat it. It's just that pure and simple. Well, look at here. This prevalence of financial abuse is higher than that of systolic heart failure. Now, you'd treat systolic heart failure, wouldn't you? So let's start treating the issues related to financial fraud. Well, the whole goal is just frankly to raise this clinical awareness and provide information and resources about what you can do. Don's going to give you a bunch of them in a minute. It goes without saying that we have a vulnerable population that's large and growing, and financial loss, of course, impacts all of our facets of our lives. This is kind of a scary thought. I hope you're not among them. 150% of elders live within the poverty level. That's not a lot of money. The average savings of today's baby boomers, the youngest of the boomers and the millennials coming up, don't have a lot of money, and I don't know what they're going to do to retire well. So again, we just want to keep on bringing this to your attention, bring you resources, and we'll go into some of those in just another slide. This one you saw in the video, which I think is excellent. Very quick definition of investment fraud, the illegal or improper use of another individual's resources for financial personal profit or gain. Undue influence is one of the big ones. How many of you ever heard of that term in a legal sense, undue influence? Good number of you have. When exploiters, whether family, and sadly, a lot of this is, most of it probably is family members, acquaintances or strangers use their power to deceptively gain control of the decision-making of a victim. Let's take two cases in Houston, Texas, that came from our panel of patients at the Huffington Center on Aging at Baylor College of Medicine. Mr. Allen's an 83-year-old man who lacks financial capacity due to mild cognitive impairment. He's involved his son, Stephen. These names have been changed to protect the innocent, of course. In some financial decisions. While Mr. Allen is a conservative investor, Stephen likes to take risks. He invests a large portion of his father's retirement funds in a risky stock. Soon afterwards, the stock falls dramatically. We could have said 2007, it would have pertained to all of us. Out of embarrassment, Stephen just doesn't tell his daddy what he's done. Is this fraud? Well, I hear a lot of yeses. When we ran it by our legal colleagues, it'd be a hard one to prove because his father had given him the okay to do it. His son certainly created an ethical situation when he didn't tell his dad what he'd done. But it's probably not fraud in the context of this next one that I'm going to show you. Ms. Hartford is an 86-year-old recent widow. Her daughter May hires a caregiver, Susan, to help around the house. May notices that Susan is acquiring lots of new things. That's your first red flag, isn't it? Then May discovers she cannot access her mother's accounts anymore. She visits her mother. Susan is nowhere to be found. She had unduly influenced Mrs. Hartford into signing a durable power of attorney. She then depleted Ms. Hartford's retirement funds. And once May realized what was happening, Susan took what was left and ran. Is this fraud? Yeah. Absolutely. And we sure hope they catch this lady and put her in jail for a real long time. Caregivers, family members, terrible. Trusted financial advisors, like in Chris Cox's father's case. They sell inappropriate annuities, and Don can clarify this. This notion of what's appropriate and inappropriate for an elder is a key thing to know. And strangers, the scams by phone. I gave this talk one time and a lady came up to me. She said, you know, I teach some of this stuff in my business course at Texas Tech. Now, she'd taken her doctorate at Texas Tech. She teaches at Southwest Texas State University in San Marcos, Texas. She said, my older mother lives with me and said, I came home one day after having talked about this in my class. Mama, did you have a nice day? Oh, yeah. Nicest young man called me. We just talked forever. You know, and well, what'd y'all talk about? Well, I'm going to buy this, that, and the other. You know, and it just goes to show you it happens all over America. It happens in the most subtle of contexts. And had it not been for the daughter picking up on it, this lady might have lost a lot of money. Who are the traits? I want to point out, this doesn't have a flash on it, but down at the bottom, Tooth, Michael Tooth, if you want to review the literature, he was the very first person in the medical literature that we could find that was publishing things about this years ago. He's a psychiatrist by training. But the traits are the caregivers, male, usually relative, living with the patient, economically dependent upon the patient, has a history of mental illness, including substance abuse and so forth. So that's who you want to look out for. An increase in dependency on others arises from vulnerability, so forth and so on. We'll kind of flip through some of it. What are these simple office-based assessments that you can run? In an office, we've got some people right now doing it on tablets, and while they're waiting to be seen, we give them a tablet, and they play with it, and the questions that they answer are revealing. And so, we have this clinician's pocket guide. We were to have had some here today, but Atlanta is sick and couldn't get them. Hopefully, we'll be able to get those to you. But they have a lot of good information in it. And should I be concerned if you're a clinician or any kind, if you have a fiduciary responsibility for an older person, doesn't make any difference whether you're a medical doctor or nurse or a social worker. The red flags in the patient and client history are reasons to be aware of. Red flags, we talked about social isolation, bereavement, dependence upon others, alcohol or drug abuse, which is a big one, by the way, and depression or mental illness. Fearful, emotionally labile or distressed, suspicious, delusional, cognitive problems. And this last one, this whole notion of self-neglect. Boy, what a terrible problem. You've all seen people with self-neglect. And so that's a real key. So be aware of that. A change in, well, that goes with the self-neglect. How many of you are aware of the mini-cog or have ever used it? All right. Well, we should have just had a little three-minute session here to Dr. Thompson was here, she could tell you exactly how to do it. There she is. you want to tell them how to do it, Dolores? Okay, all right. Yeah, go to the website. I'm an OPE major. I think I could do it. So anyhow, when you do this and you run the results of the screen, it's normal aging worries and money issues, no particular vulnerability. Possibly vulnerable enough to warrant referral to further testing or professional assistance, and a suspicion that fraud has already occurred. And let me stop and make this point. Our whole purpose is to prevent the fraud. That's what you're here for. Try to prevent it. But if you find it and you recognize it, you got to report it. So that's what can come from the mini-cog, and I think we commend it to you. Don Marson's FCI is called the Financial Capacity Instrument. Is the only validated instrument that we know of on persons with dementia that can really has enough sensitivity to pick up financial lack of financial capacity and makes them more vulnerable. So if you're not familiar with Dan Marson's work, commend him to reading. This was a, and I would go back and I'd look at this, if you can Google this New York Times piece. The lady who wrote it is Liz, no, what's her name, Don? This medical, it's not on here. Well, that's the photo used. Elizabeth Olsen, thank you. She's really an award-winning, I don't know if she's ever won a Pulitzer Prize, but she's close. She really is on top of all these things associated with aging. So she called me one day. She said, Bob, do you know of any clinician that y'all have had in these CME programs around the country that actually uses this and has found people that he or she deems vulnerable and done something about it? I said, yeah, I sure do. The very first program that we put on was in San Antonio, Texas. in 2009. And this fellow comes up to me and he said, Bob, I'm Bob Parker. I'm head of the geriatric section of the Department of Family Medicine, UT Health Science Center here in San Antonio. And he said, I can think of 20 of my patients I need to go screen tomorrow. I just never had thought about this. He said, can we use your slides to help train our fellows? And I said, well, sure, Dr. Parker. And so Ms. Olson called Dr. Parker. They had a nice interview. And this article is really, really fascinating. And that's a picture of Bob attending to one of his older patients in San Antonio. So how do you introduce the issue to your patient? We've all been reared, raised, or whatever term you want to use, to not talk about certain things. Politics, be a smart one not to talk about. Think of some other thing. And money. So you just don't start, well, how much money you make? Well, you never ask that. But you got to get at it in a subtle way. And so we used some focus groups of physicians who actually see older patients in their practices. So how would you do this? And following Bob's New York Times article, you'd just kind of say, well, I just read this in the New York Times or the Washington Post or San Francisco, what y'all's maybe newspaper here, the Chronicle, the Herald or whatever. And about elders being financially exploited, and I just thought I'd talk to my own mama about it, and then why not just talk to all my patients about it? You know, let's get at this. And so then we did a focus group of older people and said, if your doctor asks you, would it be okay for him or her to ask you a few questions about this in the context of this notion of mild cognitive impairment and other issues, would they mind? And they said no. So we just started doing it. So we asked, who manages your money day to day, and how's that going? Anybody ever asked you that question? All right. Do you run out of money at the end of the month? I do. Do you regret or worry about financial decisions you've recently made? Have you given power of attorney to another person? Do you have a will? And has anyone asked you to change it? So a few things like that. If these answers raise suspicion, then there are referral sections in this clinician's pocket guide. And by the way, you can get that off of the IPT's website, and we'll show you the link to that in a minute, so forth and so on. So are you having any of these following concerns? I have trouble paying bills. I don't feel confident making big financial decisions alone. I don't understand financial decisions that someone else is making for me. I got a call from TIA Cref. How many of y'all are with TIA Cref, university people, the other day? And they said they'd made a change in my plan for personal wealth management. And I'm not signed up for personal wealth management. and don't have enough money in there for personal wealth management, sadly. In my next life, by the way, I'm not going to do grants. I'm going to teach wealthy widows at Palm Beach Country Club how to play golf and make some money. But they wanted to know, so I had to call them and get it straightened out, because they're going to start dinging me 1%, you know, on my money. So you got to be careful. Everybody needs to be careful. People are calling, making me, asking for money. Someone's accessing my accounts, so forth and so on. So what types of referral can you have? And so here kind of they are. Fraud and exploitation may have already occurred. Need legal counsel. The elder lawyers, and Don's going to talk about the new EFFE. This is EFE medical. Now we got EFE legal, and Don's going to tell you about that in a minute. Let me just flip through this. Here's Tooth again talking about how do you deal with the person you think is the problem when they bring the elder patient into the doctor's office. Observe for the following behaviors, demeaning comments, threat to change doctors, and so forth and so on. Here are referral sources. How many of you use the United Way's 211 number? We really use that big time in Houston. It really works great. National Association of Professional Geriatric Care Managers, Don just sent me an email yesterday. They've changed their name, and it's called Aging Life Care, I think, Don. So the people are now called Aging Life Care Professionals as opposed to Geriatric Care Managers. Are any of you certified geriatric nurse care managers? Okay. So do you know about your new organization? Okay. Yeah. And so forth and so on. So then, since we're in California, Tip O'Neill said all politics are local. And so everything here is California specific. The Department of Business Oversight that Atlanta is with, had she been here, she would have talked about it. Adult Protective Services, these are all numbers that will get you right to the California folks, your local Attorney General's office, Department of Insurance, and so forth and so on. So we all know to do these things. Getting near the end here, what can you say to your patients? Be aware of your own vulnerability. Be aware of who wants your money. Be aware of how you can protect yourself, and be aware of who can help you. And so you're talking to your patient, now let me talk to you. We're all in this game together. As we age, things happen. Most of them are good, but some can be bad. And you need to be aware of your own vulnerability. You need to have conversations with your family. What if this were to happen? What would you do? This is what I want done. So tip to the way. Mark Lax is down in Orlando, Florida right now at the American Geriatric Society. We should have flown Mark up here, great guy. Wrote a book, chapter 17 and 18 are immunizing your patients from bad financial decisions. He talks about this. It's a fascinating read, should get the book. And then Ronan Factora, a young geriatrician at Case Western Reserve University in Cleveland, the Cleveland Clinic, got a new book out called Aging and Money. So there are lots of good resources out there for you. And we're going to get to the best ones, though, are the Clinician's Pocket Guide and the Patient Education Brochure that you can obtain from the IPT's website. And now I'm going to turn this over to Don, who's going to skip to his presentation, and we're going to come back to what Lana would have done had she been here. So again, let me just close and say, one, how grateful we are to be here, to have this large crowd. To have you who know aging and dementia better than anybody and who has experience, and we want to hear from you a little bit later. And so without further ado, my colleague Don Blandon. Yeah. Oh, okay, Don wants me to take the questions now on this part, and then we'll wrap it up. So I want you to either come forth and ask questions at the mics, or if you have a story, a case, share it with us. Who wants to be first? I'm going to start pointing at people if you don't raise your hand. Here comes a lady at the mic. Tell us who you are and where you're from. They're going to get the mic for you. Wait just a minute. Is it working? Mic not working?
Testing.
My name is Marguerite Moriarty. I have a story.
She has a story. Marguerite has a story. Go ahead, Marguerite.
Just briefly. My mother, she's passed away now, but I hired a caregiver in New Jersey for her, and she was living with my brother, who's not that highly functioning. And my mother's friend passed away and left her $20,000, which was deposited into her account. And then the caregiver, whom I hired and got good references on, ended up, she had some medical problems. And the long story short, she was having my mother sign checks, and then she was taking them into the Bank of America and getting them cashed to the tune of $9,000. And I ended up trying to resolve it with her. Nothing ever happened. I did file with the police, and they said that, like what you presented, is that, my mother signed the checks, and so, they just could never prove that my mother didn't do it willingly, yeah. So it does happen, even when you get good references. I mean, whatever was going on with this lady, used bad judgment.
Yeah.
And, my mother lost $9,000.
Well, I'm sorry to hear that. That's almost like Ms. Hartford's case. It happens all across the country. I think there's a lady standing over here that would like to share that with us. Thank you, ma'am.
My name is Tippi Irwin. I'm the Director of Ombudsman Services here in San Mateo County. And in California, we are responsible for investigating abuse in the long-term care facilities. So we do what Adult Protective Services does in most other states. I have a lot of stories, but I'm going to tell you one particular story. Our big concern is undue influence, because that's always very hard to prove, and we sometimes have some very irate clients when we interfere. We had a case where a man, one of our ombudsmen was visiting a facility, and he'd been going there for months and months and months before a client actually spoke to him and said that she wanted to tell her story. She had showed him, she showed him a piece of paper ripped off from a textbook, just a piece of paper. And written on it was, I owe you $50,000.
Oh, my goodness.
Wow. There was no date. There was just an initial on it, no date. It was a very informal document. And she told the story that when she before she came into the facility, the caregiver, the woman that had ripped her off, had given her this IOU, had been her caregiver in her, at her own home. Mm. She had given her permission. She'd given her the right to write checks. She had become her rep payee, in fact. Mm. So she was paying all her bills. When she came into the facility, the woman continued to visit with her, plus her family members. She had taken the $50,000 out to buy a tanning salon for her daughter. We have to have permission from the individual before we can investigate. That's the rules for ombudsman. Mm-hmm. She refused to let us investigate the story.
Yeah. Yeah.
And what she had done was she had weighed up whether she wanted to continue to receive the visits from this family because they were the only people from the outside world that came to see her, or whether she wanted to pursue and prosecute. So we did nothing about it.
Uh-huh.
We could not.
That's another sad story, and again, I've heard this many, many times. We had a case in Houston. Can't tell you too much about it. Person was a very, very well-known person. In his 80s in a long-term care facility, calls up CarMax and says, I want a late model go Lexus, and I want it here tomorrow. Now, he's in a memory care unit, and how in the world this guy got in there in the first place, I don't know, but he took him to the bank, and the guy took out $30,000 and paid cash for that Lexus. Well, in a way, it's not fraud because the young car salesman just doing, well, hey, man, that's a pretty good deal. But the bank, somebody's got to say, whoa, wait a minute, this doesn't sound right, does it? Let's hold off till tomorrow before we consummate this transaction. He did get his money back, and the car went back, and we actually talked to the president and CEO of CarMax United States, and he agreed that, you know, we need to have a little bit better judgment. Yes, ma'am.
Well, I have a story that's sort of the flip side of what you're talking about, and that is that my twin brother was diagnosed with Alzheimer's in 2006, and he was a very successful businessman. And in 2007, he went to his attorney to get a new will because he realized he was going to die before, you know, he thought he was. And he set up a foundation where most of his money was going to go to. And then left his children, we thought, with quite a bit of money each. And my brother's still alive. He now has severe Alzheimer's. But his two children found out about this. And they hired an attorney. We aren't sure what they're trying to do. But no one influenced my brother. His wife is not getting anything more than she would have in the last will and blah, blah, blah. And it's really, it's heartbreaking for our entire family because we've been a very generous family. My brother was super generous. Yeah. And it's sort of not looking at someone's history. And because he was diagnosed with Alzheimer's, it's like, oh, our dad wasn't competent.
Right.
And it's
well,
really
again, another sad story, and Don will tell you more how the EFI legal maybe can be of more help to people like this than the EFI medical. Yes, ma'am, you have a story, too.
Yes, I just attended a lecture by UC Hastings School of Law. Mm-hmm. There's a new medical legal partnership there.
Good.
And according to the director there, according to California probate law, a diagnosis of dementia does not necessarily mean that the person does not have capacity in the state of California. So that's really important for people to understand because as long as the person can understand the consequences of their decision making, they still have capacity.
Mm-hmm.
Does everybody hear that?
Yeah.
So I know you gave an example about mild cognitive impairment,
right.
But it's really important to make sure that that person has decision making capacity, and the decisions can be individual decisions,
right?
Like in a particular circumstance.
Right.
So executive
functional capacity is the root of all of this, and there's a lady at Iowa that's done research called the Iowa Gambling Task. Her name is Natalie Denberg, a neuropsychologist, and she has shown that any damage to the prefrontal cortex of our brains, which is where all of this executive functioning capacity resides. In fact, everybody take your forefinger and put it right here. There it is. Now, if you're in a car wreck and you hit the windshield, or if you're Pele and you headed the ball all these years, if you're an NFL football player, all this damage, if you're a boxer, right there, Parkinson's disease, Lewy body dementia, all this stuff makes you less risk averse, meaning you're willing to gamble. So there's a neurobiological basis for a lot of this stuff. Yes, ma'am.
I'm Elna Times. I chair the Santa Clara County Senior Care Commission.
Mm-hmm.
I have a client who is a good friend who is very bright. She's a Mensa person. She is 54, and she has had MS for the last 10 years, and it has affected her to the point where I can diagnose MCI.
Mm-hmm.
She is a free spirit and has never married, but has had a series of boyfriends, most of whom have been okay, but the last one decided that she represented a financial asset.
Mm-hmm.
He convinced her mother, who is not an attorney but talks like one, to take power of attorney for my friend.
Yeah.
In that power of attorney, she ran up credit card bills supposedly to buy a house, and then defaulted on all of them, forcing my client into bankruptcy the second time.
Wow.
She then proceeded to kick my friend out of the two houses that she owned, one in Menlo Park and one in Sunnyvale, and put in there two groups of veterans with problems, and told them, first of all, the lady qualified for Section 8 housing, so she got money from the government for that. And then in addition, she, because of her power of attorney, was able to take my friend's disability checks. And in addition to that, the clients that she brought into Kanita's houses were paying her rent in the order of $800 a month in cash, but never reporting it. Meanwhile, she forced my client out of both houses and into B&B kinds of arrangements. We got into this, and we tried to do that, and discovered that because she's 54, she doesn't qualify for any of the elder financial abuse help. We got no help from the Sunnyvale Police Department, the Santa Clara County District Attorney, SALA, or the Elder Fraud Institutes.
Yeah. How sad. Don's going to talk about stuff like that. There's another case. We may have to let this be the last one so we can turn it over to Don. Can we hear you? We can't hear her. Why don't you come over here to this mic? That way we can hear you real good. We'll let this be the last one. While she's coming up, I'll tell you that I went to my 55th high school. Oh, has you got it working?
Hello? No. Yes.
Can you hear? Okay, yay. All right.
Hi, I'm Lindsay. I'm a social worker up in San Francisco at the Institute on Aging.
Great.
I have a couple questions for
Surely.
You. The first one is, I'm fortunate enough to work in a agency that has a money management rep payee program.
Right.
Oftentimes I work with older adults that do have dementia,
mm-hmm.
and I find that it is difficult to convince them to use the money management program.
Mm-hmm.
They oftentimes develop a mistrust of me,
mm-hmm.
Asking questions about
right.
their finances. Do
yep.
you have any advice on how to help?
Well, that's a great question. It is a tough call. It's been said that many elders are just almost stubborn to a fault. My wife accuses me of being that way. My daddy was kind of like that, come think of it. But I don't know. What are some answers to this question that's just been posed? Who would offer a good social worker a tip on how to work with older people who just flat don't want your advice? Okay, this lady right here wants to say something.
To access about financial capacity evaluations. So for someone with Mm-hmm. There are tests you can, that people can do to demonstrate that they no longer have capacity for financial
right.
decisions, in which case a DPOA for finances would be effective. Yeah.
That's a good point. Read up on Dan Marson's work in Alabama, because he actually works with people. I think he showed a video done at one of our programs of an older gentleman that he was working with. And oftentimes these people don't want to admit they have it, and their caregivers either don't want to admit it or they do, but then there's these family dynamics. And it's a tough call. I mean, it is not easy. It is really not easy. Your second question.
And then, yeah, one last thing. I work with an older adult right now who she has a rep payee actually already, but she is in a very vulnerable position, and we highly suspect she is being financially exploited by someone in her home. So she constantly, I interface with the rep payee. She constantly asks me for ledgers and printouts of her financial information, which I'm very hesitant to give her because I don't want it to end up in the hands of the gentleman that we suspect is exploiting her.
Right, the exploiter, yeah.
So, I mean, any tips on sort of how to, I mean, she's starting to become suspicious of me because I'm giving her the verbal information, you know, weekly, but she doesn't retain it because her dementia is quite advanced.
Well, again, a tough call. Don knows a lawyer down in San Diego. He can tell you about in a minute, the prosecutor. And there's another lady up in Seattle, Washington, that we just think the world of. And we'll get you that information, and maybe you can either contact them, because they work with these situations. And you have to protect the person against the exploiter. If you tip your hand too much, then the exploiter, you know, is going to clam up and not participate or run off with more money, as the case might be. Again, this whole notion of capacity and how you deal with people that you think or don't have the capacity to make sound financial decisions and so forth and so on. I went to my 55th high school reunion, hard to believe, 2 weeks ago, ran into one of my classmates, said, "Bob, let me ask you a question since you're in geriatrics." Said, "My 98-year-old daddy has got several $1 million worth of what was then the Humble Company." All these guys in Baytown, Texas, where we're from, worked for the plant, the Humble Oil and Refining Company. It's now ExxonMobil. So if you had a lot of Humble stock back in the day and you never did spend it, you're worth millions, like his daddy is. His mama dies, and he hires this lady to come in and help him. She's about 65 years old. He's 98. And pretty soon, things start changing. And so Paige says, "What can I do for my daddy?" And I said, "Well, first of all, does he have full capacity to do this?" He said, "Oh, yes, the guy's sharp as a tack." I said, "It's his money." You know, it's sad, but he has the capacity to make these decisions with his money. And so there's the rub. It is not easy. We've got to turn this over to Don. We've got about 30 minutes left in the program. But thank you for your kind attention, and we'll maybe see you after the program's over.
Let me start by saying that we are a charitable trust. We're a foundation. We're a 501c3. We don't sell anything. We don't collect any information. We don't store any information that's personal. But we give everything away, and we pay for that from fines that we've received when we weren't able to get them back to money back to, say, the original victim. And since there's millions and billions of dollars that have been lost by victims, and we try to get the money back to the victim, but occasionally we can't find the victim, or we just can't somehow get the money to the person. So that goes into education. And in our case, it's investor education. So we do investor protection through research and education. So when Bob said, we have funded this, we have funded that, the programs we're talking about, we do that through the foundation. So I'm saying that if you want to send us an email and you see any of the material that you'd like a hard copy of, send it to me personally on our email site. It's blandon@investorprotection.org or info@investorprotection.org. We have a new website, which we also have under protectinvestors.org. But I decided let's do something that people can remember from a radio interview while they're driving on the freeway in California. And that would be info@iinvest, like iPhone, iPad, iSomething, iinvest.org. You could just send information to me or info, and we'll make sure, working with Alana and the California Department of Business Oversight will get you some. Will get you what you want. Would Bob early? By the way, if anybody was keeping a list of what Bob said Don would do, Don would provide. Don would give you. Let me know, because I stopped taking notes. I thought the last one, by the way, the answer to your last one is Paul Greenwood in San Diego, a nationally known attorney, prosecutor, who goes after folks who have done bad deeds to the rest of us. And very eloquent speaker. I've been to his congressional testimony many times when he's speaking on this particular subject. But I want to, because you'll notice that a lot of the, what we're trying to do is help you with your basically client base or the people you're trying to help as caregivers, adult protective services professionals in the room, you know who we're speaking of that you're trying to help. But also, we do investor education for all ages and help people become what we call wise and safe investors. I've kind of coined that term, and wise is that you understand the process of investing before you're buying products that you don't understand. Bob mentioned also the issue of annuities, and Don would explain that. I can explain that, but we don't have the time for that. But I know that when an 80-year-old is sold an annuity by someone who's getting a big commission, and the annuity matures in 30 years, that's not a good idea. Just not a good idea. So we have to make sure that the people we're working with, the financial advisors we're working with, have in writing that they are taking a fiduciary responsibility. It's a big, long word. I had to look it up. I graduated from Fremont High School in Oakland, so there's a lot of things I have to look up after all these years. By the way, Bob mentioned his 55th anniversary of his high school and gave you his name. Well, you can do the math here. This year is the 50th anniversary of the Fremont High Mighty Tigers class of 1965. Their senior class president for the entire year is standing right here. Go Tigers! Every 5 years, our class, which is very diverse, our class looked like what California is today, the rich diversity, the beautiful mosaic of people that we represent. Our class looked like that in 1964, 1965, when I was at Fremont High. And we still get together every 5 years. And those of us who are still here, we've lost a few people, but that'll be over in Oakland, California, in October, October 24th, for example, if you're at Jack London Square, come visit. And you can see us. But Carrie Hannon, this is what I'm trying to get to. You're saying, boy, it takes a long time. By the way, I'm not gonna try to tell any jokes. Bob and I have got a, Bob's got a 2 o'clock boarding at San Francisco Airport after this, and I know I'm the only one standing between you and lunch. So I'll be fast as well. But I just want to, by the way, Bob's coming back next week for 5 nights in the lounge here at the hotel. If you liked him today, you'll love the whole show. It's really great. Carrie Hannon is a nationally known author and jobs expert for the AARP. They used to hate being called ARP. I said ARP once, and I almost got beat up by this cute little old woman with really, really old. She was like 92 with blue hair. We don't call ourselves ARP. It's AARP. But now you'll notice the commercial, they have AARP. Or, so now I've said, you know, as Dave Barry said in the column, the world according to ARP. But ARP, or AARP, has tremendous resources. Oh, I'm not doing an ad for them because I'm a member, but not I don't get money. But Carrie Hannon has been going with us around to different aging conferences, and she's got 2 books I want you to be aware of, and I have copies of them, and I can send you what I have. What's Next? Your guide to a working retirement, finding your passion and your dream job. After the last recession, a lot of us are finding that we need to work longer than we expected to. We took a big hit. I know, some of us anyway in the room. I'm not going to ask for hands, except for mine. My wife and I were married 16 years. We got married in Sausalito. We're both from California. And after 16 years, we said, gee, were we going to do something else? Let's see. And we said, oh, yeah, kids. So we flew to Barbados, which dinks do, dual income, no kids. I'm one of the, you know, the kind of the old yuppies, if you remember them. And our son was born 9 months later. That was after the second rum drink at the pool. Our daughter, 22 months later. So we have a 25-year-old daughter and a 27-year-old son, and we're in our, I'm 8 days older than my wife, we're getting close to Bob's age, which I won't call old. I won't call old because Paul McCartney, when he was 17 years old, wrote that song, When I'm 64. You may remember it. Will you still need me? Will you still feed me when I'm 64? And when he turned 64, he was asked by a reporter, which you would imagine a reporter would there be anything he would change? And he said, I would change the lyrics to When I'm 84. And now he's 72, 73. You and...
75 or something. No, 73.
You must be thinking of Mick Jagger or Keith Richards, who's 110. But anyway, we did a booklet at this last conference, the Oklahoma Aging Conference. This is a plug for Oklahoma, where I barely got out of the airport. There was a tornado landing last week. If you heard about the tornadoes, we were the last flight out by 5 minutes. Then they evacuated. So. But this booklet has really good information for people in their 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, and beyond by Carrie. And the reason I mentioned it to you is having a checklist by age group is really important, because then we can kind of check it off. Something that people like to do. And I really like all of your advice, and we'll be glad to send you a free copy of this. If you just want to ask for it, you could say, we'll just say I saw you at, I saw you in Foster City. Send me the stuff, and we'll send it to you. Preferably by email, but if not, we've got some hard copies. The one thing I disagree with Carrie on, it says, and some of you other parents in the room might not like this either, maybe just me, but one of her recommendations to people in their 20s, move in with your parents to keep housing costs down. So I can understand that. They go to college, they're paying some of the tuition, we're paying some of the tuition too, which is why I can't retire ever. Move in with your parents to keep housing costs down is one of her recommendations. And I said, the first time I heard that, I was introducing her and I said, no way. My wife and I are starting to date again after 22 years, and I'm not going to tan any of that. So let me get started. You'll wonder why I'm not doing the program. The EFI medical program, thank you very much. I got the, is that a 5 or a 15? 5. 15. I kidding. We missed the one before, which probably said 30. The EFI legal program, it is, by the way, the full title is EFI Prevention Program, Elder Investment Fraud and Financial Exploitation Prevention Program. Because a lot of us in this room deal with victims all the time, people who've already been victimized. What we're trying to do is get professionals, different professionals in different categories, so to speak, different professions, I'll say, to be able to help us. It takes a village. I know that's a overused term maybe, but it takes a village to try to find people, to help to find people who might be at risk to financial exploitation. And as we know, as we age and we're older, you lose all your investments or all your savings, and it can be absolutely devastating. Violet, the woman in the, she's a very strong woman. She said in the shower, I'm a woman. You'll remember Violet, she had orange hair. She is sharp as a tack, and but she still has faith and still has courage to stay active, stay engaged, but she still trusts maybe a little bit too much, because she was a victim, and she is, I thought, a great person for that particular show. Karen, the younger woman whose mother had died, as she said, without any assets, and said, I wish I had known, I wish I had taken action early. She said that I'm to blame, and I know people can feel that way, but we're all trying to help people. My mother was until she died at age 45 when I was 11, my mother was a pillar of my Oakland, California community. She was the go-to person. So in her honor, I thought that I should be in some kind of an education role, nonprofit role,
for the rest of my career. And I've found it very rewarding, as I hope all of you do, for all that you do to help others who are in need. The key thing to focus on here is that this program is really taking what we've learned from the medical program and applying it to lawyers and judges, to be able to let lawyers and judges spot potential signs of elder financial abuse. The American Bar Association approached us. They had seen what the Baylor College of Medicine had done with the pilot program for medical doctors and healthcare professionals. The program is also now online, so if you're in the medical profession, you can get a CME or a continuing nurses credit through the program, which is online, and we can give you that information. It's on the website, so I'll show you in just a minute. And here's why the ABA is involved with it. It's a human rights issue, elder financial exploitation. It's a rule of law issue. It's an issue of professionalism. And lawyers and their family members are not immune, making it a personal issue. And I think we all ought to view this as a personal issue. Yes, it could happen to us or someone we care about. When we did a survey, and we have a copy of the full survey and the results of it on our website, over 91% of practicing lawyers who completed the survey said that this is a very serious problem or somewhat serious, and they also recognize that it's growing. So we have gotten their attention, and this is why. And I'm going to read it to you. I don't like to read usually PowerPoints, but every lawyer, not just those who practice elder law, needs to understand how this growing epidemic may affect them professionally and personally, as demonstrated by the sensational Brooke Astor case. A lawyer who is ignorant of elder financial exploitation may fail to protect a client from harm or unwittingly participate in the client's victimization. Such lawyers may face professional discipline, liability for malpractice, or even criminal charges. If you're a lawyer, the last line really kind of gets your attention. And in the issue of may unwittingly help, we've seen abuses of power of attorney, financial power of attorney, and there's an example of what we're talking about there. The role of civil lawyers, people who practice civil law, I'm not talking about criminal law now where you have a state prosecutor who is prosecuting to basically put someone in jail for doing something that not only hurts an individual or a family or a group of people or the entire culture we live in, like breaking into a house because our house is a place we're supposed to be safe. So trying to put somebody in jail, but civil law is more of a disagreement among the parties. So you don't like what your financial planner has done or your broker dealer has done, and you think that they've been maybe churning your investments, meaning they've been trading and selling and buying on just general direction from you, and there's really no reason for it other than they were making a lot of big commissions while you might have been losing money. As you know, when a person who's in the securities, selling securities, when they make money, when they lose money, they're still going to get paid. You, not so much. You can read, as just probably all read these already, but these are the reasons, because there's a role for civil lawyers. And then the role of the criminal justice system is to enforce the law, protect the public, and hold the perpetrators accountable through prosecution, punishment, restitution to victims, and then supervision of the perpetrators for a time after to make sure they don't do it again. A lot of the fraud we see in this country is not only done over and over, but it's sometimes done over and over to the same people. Because the people who've been victims once are easily led to being a victim twice and even three times. We've seen that a lot. Lawyers' roles in improving systems or building public awareness, which is why not only are we doing the continuing legal education for judges and lawyers, but we're also going to do a national campaign, public awareness about how to protect yourself and your loved ones from financial exploitation. Pro bono services you've heard about, I'm sure you're even working with lawyers who provide that, and multidisciplinary teams like the FAST system here in California have done wonders to get quick action when we see someone at risk, because if you don't act quickly, overnight, they could lose their entire savings. Here are a couple of things. There's that and at imvest.org. You can be info. It can be Blandon, but that'll reach me, and we will respond to you. And the person at the American Bar Association is Lori Stiegel. You have that in the PowerPoint that's been given to you in the black and white version that you have with the notes section. It's 7 pages back. In case you can't find it, it didn't immediately follow because Alana was supposed to go before me. So what I'm going to do now is, Tom, can you put up there the investor education and protection one that was right behind Bob's? Tom's my new best friend. You got to do that. I used to personnel people in when you got hired when I was. I worked 2 years for Governor Reagan. I'm the only person you know who's worked for both Governor Reagan and Governor Carter, both as governors and when they were presidents. That's why I'm still in the nonprofit world instead of in government. So I have 2 years of state government and 4 years of federal, so that's, and I don't have a big advanced degrees like Bob, but it's Cal State Hayward, which is now Cal State East Bay. So this is a kind of a sad photo, isn't it? I look like this all the time when I'm paying my college tuition bills. There are 4 of us in our family. My son and daughter have, you know, the normal college bills. My wife, when she was 55, decided to go back. She was 20 years at the Brookings Institution as a vice president and the Center for Public Policy Education. She came home and said, I want to quit, and I want to get my doctoral degree, and I want to teach. And I said, sure, great. Not thinking about the impact that was going to have on us. So she decided to go to George Washington University, which has the highest tuition in the world or something like that. So I'm the only one not paying student loans in our family. Well, I'm paying them, but I'm not. Well, you can figure that out. I don't want to say it. It makes me horrible. It's Bernard Madoff. Bernard Madoff is his name. We popularized it a little bit to say, let's make a little form of Bernie, and then we'll call it Madoff. So we could say he made off with your money. So for whatever you want to call him, Bernard Madoff, he did some really bad things. He used the Ponzi scheme named after Mr. Ponzi a long time ago when he did this and took a lot of smart people who should have known better and lost a lot of money. Good news is, a lot of that money was recovered over time, but it also took its toll, as you well know, in a very serious way. It is scams that affect everyone. And for every Madoff-type Ponzi scheme, there's a lot of really smaller Ponzi schemes. So your securities regulator is California Department of Business Oversight. You've got that information. Alana, apologize that she's not here today, but we can get you information on the state securities regulator. Every state has one. They're helping to protect you if you're having any issues related to your investments and how to file a complaint. But here's the main thing that you should know, because they do a lot of prosecution, they do a lot of enforcement action, compliance action. What's important to you is if you're talking to a financial advisor and you're interviewing, please, at least 3 people to try to find the right one, or you're working with a broker-dealer, don't just go to something called BrokerCheck, which is online. Go to your securities regulator, the Department of Business Oversight, and ask them to check out the background of anybody who's trying to sell you any kind of financial product, because they have much more information that isn't, as you've read recently in the newspapers, that isn't expunged from after time, isn't just kind of taken out, because sometimes the people who do this, who don't manage your money well, they won't manage it for a very long time. So you've got to be real careful you're working with people who don't have complaints. This is information about what investment fraud is. I think we know enough about that to kind of skip over this one. But here's who needs to be registered. People in brokerage firms, security salesperson. We have a booklet on our website, and I can send you a hard copy, or you can look at the website. It's called Getting Help, and it will really help you learn how to get the right person to help you with your money management. And don't feel that you have to have a certain amount of money to have money management, because you need to become a wise and safe investor. And we have a lot of things that will take you through that. Investment advisors, this is what basically the definition, a person, a business entity engaged in the business of providing advice. And then here are the things that you're supposed to expect. Full disclosure, they don't talk to you about fees up front, walk out. Don't buy anything. And other issues, and keep paperwork, like monthly account statements. Keep that for a while, because if there's ever a dispute, surprise, surprise, the people who are managing your money and you're in the dispute against them, you find it very hard to get information from them after the fact. So you need to keep your own records, anything related to your, it's kind of like the IRS. You know, after a certain time, you probably can get rid of some of it, but try to keep accurate files and the people you're trying to help. I mentioned churning earlier. These are some of the bad things that happen. Margin trading, unreasonable expectations. The common advisor schemes are doing things that you aren't aware of, and here are some of the things that you aren't aware of that will hurt you. Affinity fraud, gas and oil schemes, internet theft. You've heard about the Nigerian internet issues and things like that. These are various types of frauds. How to spot a con artist. A lot of this is common sense, but Bernard Madoff seemed to be able to get people even with common sense and totally destroy their portfolio. So be aware of all of these as a checklist. By the way, we have copies of all of these. If you would like a little bit bigger version than the one you have here, you can just email me and we'll send it, or we'll automatically send it to you. Investigate before you invest. This is how you reach the California Department of Oversight. You can just go and Google. It'll come right up. They have a nice website. And they have forms that you can fill out. What government agency doesn't have a form when you call them? Okay? And keep a paper trail. Role of other government agencies, you don't need that right now. Those are some of the materials we can send you for free. I mentioned the getting help. I told you about the ABA program. You don't need the references. Those are the more contact information. And I'm going to take 1 minute and 30 seconds to show you something, because one of the things we have to do is think about our future, regardless of where we are today in the present. We have to always be in the present, but we should think about our future. And my daughter thinks that I should be doing something different than what I'm doing now. So, Tom, if you can just load it, but don't start it yet. The background on this is that I was traveling through London, and I saw an ad on a television while waiting for a flight to Spain. This is several years ago. It was a commercial for red meat. So what you're going to see is, if you're a vegetarian, may offend you, but hopefully not. But what this is what why my daughter for Father's Day gave me a guitar. Because I've seen the Beatles twice and Elvis Presley once live in concert, so I'm probably ready to go at this point if they want to take me. But somewhere down there, there's a rocker. And if I live long enough and I could learn the guitar, I want to maybe be a rocker, and I want to just show you this particular one and hit the volume up, and then we're going to go to lunch.
Best, you need protein, omega-3s, iron, zinc, and vitamin B12. Eating at least 3 to 4 red meat meals a week will help sustain your vitality and well-being, especially as you get older.
How am I looking, guys?
This way, folks.
Sure, come on.